Our suffering's here, work King of Zion. It is my inheritance. Over storms may be despised by some, they are precious truths I love. Oh Zion, what glorious things we have heard of thee. Perfection of beauty, the joy of all the earth is she. From Zion, our God does shine. What a glorious sight. And the night will guide us till we stand on Zion's hill. Nothing else compares to Zion. See the beauty of the King. And all other beauties fade away in the light of Jesus' face.
Together tonight, Lord, in the work that you did in and through your servant, Lord. How you saved her, how you baptized her with your spirit, how you led her to the waters of baptism, you led her into full-time ministry. You blessed her, used her to bring blessing to many. You completed the work of her, took her to glory. For now, we give you thanks and praise tonight. Lord, we pray especially for all the dear family members who have comforted their hearts, filled them with the hope of eternal life in Christ, brighten their vision, that they might rejoice in that blessed hope of the coming of Christ. Lord, let your presence fill this place tonight, Lord, that Christ be exalted. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Glory now revealed in me, girl.
face. We shall be changed. Our body shall be changed to be like His glorious body on that day. We thank you, God bless the hope. We give you glory in Jesus' name. I'd like to read from the Word of God. The testimony of the Apostle Paul, Philippians, the third chapter, beginning in verse 8. And we relate to this because we can say that this would have been real in the life of Sister Barbara. She had been given many things, abilities and talents from heaven, and she was able to use those in life and excel. But when she came to know Christ, she laid it all aside for something higher, and that was to win Christ Himself. So as we read this, we read the testimony of the Apostle Paul, but we also can see how it was worked out in the life of Sister Barbara, the servant of God, who has gone to her reward to meet Christ. Beginning at verse 7 in Philippians, the third chapter. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. She had many things, but she counted them loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us, therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us mind the same thing. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so, as you have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto His glorious body, according to the working whereby He is able even to subdue all things unto Himself. Reading also from Revelation chapter 21, beginning at verse 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is
with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Reading from 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, beginning at verse 1. For we know that if our earthly house and this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be dwelt upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath brought us to the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. May God bless the reading of the Word of God to our lives.
Barbara Ann Bell, daughter of the late T. Dot Bell Sr. and the late Mary L. Bell, was born on January 22, 1943, in Namur County, North Carolina, the fifth of six children. Barbara was raised and received her early childhood education in Aiden, North Carolina. At an early age, she joined the Zion Chapel Free Will Baptist Church and was a regular member there. Barbara attended South Aiden High School, where she excelled academically and graduated as valedictorian. She moved to Newark, New Jersey in 1960, and after several years, attended Rutgers University, where she received a Bachelor of Science degree in Sociology and a Master of Arts degree in Psychology. Barbara went on to obtain her law degree from Seton Hall University School of Law in 1977. After working for the law firm of Owens, Banks, and Williams, Barbara opened the law practice of Barbara A. Bell, Esquire, in East Orange, New Jersey. Although Barbara seemed to be a happy person, having accomplished much in life, on the inside she was empty and miserable. As a result, she began to look for meaning for her life and a love that would fill the void in her heart. While on this search, Barbara found the Lord. At home one day, a Christian program caught her attention. A preacher was sharing about the Lord Jesus Christ, and his words went straight to her heart. The speaker invited all to surrender their lives to the Lord. Realizing that this was the love she had been looking for, Barbara opened her life to Jesus and repented for her sins. She received the Lord's forgiveness and was born again that day. After her salvation, she was water baptized and later received the baptism in the Holy Spirit alone in her home. As a new Christian, Barbara joined a church and became an active member, serving in various positions. After some time, she began to feel a hunger for something deeper, and in trying to satisfy that hunger, she started to visit different churches. While on this search, she was invited to a service at the New Testament Church in New Jersey. The warm and loving welcome she received, along with the teachings on holiness and separation, attracted her, and Barbara began attending the church regularly. She knew that she had finally found what she was looking for. Her hunger had been satisfied. As her passion and love for Jesus increased, Barbara began to have a desire to do something for him. But she had no idea how or what that meant. Not until some years later did she understand that the birth of this desire was because of God's call on her life. Once it became clear to her that the Lord was calling her to forsake everything and serve him, Barbara said yes to his call, and in 1989, she was ordained into the full-time ministry. In her service for the Lord, Sister Barbara was sent to different parts of the United States as well as overseas. She served for many years in the headquarters located in Newark, New Jersey. She also ministered in Rhode Island, Papua New Guinea, San Francisco, Trinidad, and Brooklyn. Though Sister Barbara had forsaken all, including her profession, her legal expertise proved to be an invaluable asset in the ministry. God gave her grace and wisdom to take care of many of the legal matters of the church. Her willingness to shoulder that burden was a great comfort to her elders. And that wasn't the only burden she wanted to help lift. She was always looking for ways to relieve the load of those around her, no matter who they were and no matter what the task. One of Sister Barbara's outstanding qualities was her uprightness. After she understood about living a holy life, Sister Barbara always endeavored to maintain her integrity and to be honest in all her dealings. While she was still working, when clients who were guilty of a certain charge would come to her, she would only agree to take their case if they agreed to be honest and admit their guilt. Sister Barbara would counsel them that she could not represent them if they wanted her to lie. Some would accept her counsel while others refused. But for financial gain, Sister Barbara would not violate her conscience. All throughout her ministry, she maintained a high standard of uprightness, striving to always keep her conscience clear before God and man, even when it meant admitting her own mistakes or faults. Another godly trait that Sister Barbara portrayed is seen in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 9, where we are exhorted to show hospitality to one another without grumbling. Sister Barbara was known for her loving hospitality to all who visited her faith home. Serving others gave her great delight. She also had a special love for the mission fields and would sacrifice her own needs to be able to give generously to those who were laboring tirelessly for the Lord in foreign lands. Though there are many more beautiful characteristics that were seen in Sister Barbara, all of them combined made her what most of us will remember her as, a true mother. The Lord had given her a large heart for the many spiritual children that needed the nurture and care she gave them. Not only did she minister to their physical needs, but as a spiritual mother, she made sure to feed them with the Word of God. Countless lives have been touched and transformed by her motherly love. Towards the end of 2015, Sister Barbara's health began to decline. Even in spite of increasing pain, she continued resolute in her determination to remain faithful in all the morning praising and prayers, as well as public meetings, except for the last month when she became too weak to attend. Sister Barbara's faith in the Lord was steadfast, and often when asked how she was doing, her declaration was, "I am more than a conqueror." On September 16, 2016, at 11:20 p.m., Sister Barbara's earthly labors ceased, and her heavenly ministry began in the land of pure repose, where there is no more pain. Truly, she fought the good fight of faith by God's immeasurable grace. May the Lord raise up many more with that same spirit of overcoming faith, who will also love Jesus and serve him faithfully until their last breath. And Anne, as she was affectionately called by her close friends and family, leaves to cherish her loving memory two daughters, Tammy C. Kennedy and Vanessa B. Robinson, six grandchildren, Deshaun, Saida, Delancey, Mercedes, Gabrielle, and Ayanna, five great-grandchildren, three sisters, Vivian E. DeMiret, Mildred L. Askew, and Brenda L. Battle, many beloved nieces, nephews, cousins, and a host of dear relatives and friends. She was preceded in death by her brother, T. Doc Bell Jr., and sister, Doris E. Bell.
Reading some of the condolence messages that we've received from different places. To Pastor Greg, Sister Lisa, and all the dear ones in the USA, and his servant shall serve him, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads, and they shall reign forever and ever. Revelation 22, verses 3 through 5. We are grateful to our beloved Lord Jesus Christ for the precious life and ministry of Sister Barbara Bell. Sister Barbara's life and ministry exemplified the divine attributes of her Master. She zealously lived out the truths and standards that God had revealed to her, and she was just as keen to teach it to others too. She was a great support and comfort to her leaders and those who were with her. In the last lap of her race, she proved to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ, strong in grace to endure hardness. Amidst her own battles, she was very particular to inquire after, intercede for, and encourage other sick and weak ones. We have lost a very dear sister in Christ. She will be greatly missed. Our prayers are with all the servants of God and all the loved ones at this time. May the dear Lord of the harvest raise many more laborers to fill up the vacuum left by the home call of our beloved Sister Barbara, from Pastor Gudrun, Sister Rachel, and all the servants of God in the UK. Praise the Lord, we are sad concerning the departure of our dear Sister Barbara. We met for the first time in 1995 at the Ohio Convention. We noticed precious qualities in this dear sister. She was very serious, punctual concerning the material things, how much more she was in spiritual things. She fulfilled her ministry till the end, in spite of her physical condition. It's difficult to take the place of such a beautiful servant of God. May the Lord help us to follow her example, and may the Lord comfort you all. His servants will worship him, they will see his face, and his name will be written on their foreheads. Revelation 22:4. From Brother Roshan, Sister Pauline, Sister Annie, and the servants of God in France. Dear Pastor Greg, Sister Lisa, and all the servants of God, we thank God for the life of Sister Barbara. She was a faithful servant of God who labored in the house of God. Though she battled with sickness for many months, she soldiered on without giving in and became an epitome of perseverance. Her spirit remained resolute and she triumphed to the end. How rewarding is her experience of seeing the glorious face of Jesus and the reality of heaven. May God raise up many more faithful laborers in his vineyard. From Brother Rohit, Sister Suma, and Sister Shirani in the Ireland Faith Home. He is Lord of Lords and King of Kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. Revelation 17:14. Although Sister Barbara is no longer with us, we thank God for her life. Truly she was called, chosen, and faithful. She gave her whole life to the Lord and served him faithfully for many years. She will stand with the Lamb on Mount Zion. May the Lord comfort all the sorrowing ones, strengthen all his servants, and help each one to be faithful to the end to receive the crown from Jesus. From Brother Nero, Brother Sanjay, and all the believers in Italy.
Sister Barbara fulfilled many roles as a faithful servant of God. She was a spiritual mother, a beloved sister, and a very close friend. She had a heart of gold and lavishly and willingly poured out her love to others. She gave her best in service for her Master, and she will be so greatly missed. She kept the faith of the Son of God until the very end and has received her crowns. We praise and thank God for his perfect work done in his servant and for her call to eternal glory. From Sister Doris in Sierra Leone, West Africa. To all the servants of God and the family of our late Sister Barbara Bell, if any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. John 12:26. We are saddened by the news of the passing of our beloved sister. We pray that God will grant you all the strength needed to get through this moment of time. In spite of the momentary suffering that she had to go through, she is now safe at last in the arms of Jesus. God has wonderfully completed his work of grace before taking her to Zion. Our most sincere condolences and prayers to all of you, from Brother Cliff, Sister Deborah, and Sister Angeline, and all the saints in the Seychelles. Praise the Lord, brethren. Greetings in the sweet name of Jesus. We praise God for the life of our dear Sister Barbara Bell. We were blessed to have her visit us here in Dominican Republic in 2011. Her Bible studies were very comforting. Her faithfulness and dedication to God and his servants and the believers to the very end is an example to all of us. May God raise up many more servants of God in her stead. May God comfort all who feel the loss of this precious servant of God. Praise God for laying another precious stone in Zion. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. Our prayers are with you all at this time. In his service, Pastor Ida Wei Lee, Sister Janie Ramirez, and all the workers in Dominican Republic and Haiti. Sister Barbara's name has become a household name among those of us who were under her training. Her discipline, her love, her sense of humor are things we recount almost daily in our faith home. She was much loved and appreciated and will be terribly missed. Sister Cheryl and Sister Deborah in West Moreland, Jamaica. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints, Psalm 16, verse 15. I extend my condolences to Tammy, to the family members and friends. During the early 80s, while I was stationed in Newark, New Jersey, I became more acquainted with Sister Barbara Bell. While she was still a believer in practicing law in Newark, New Jersey, I was her discipleship teacher. When she came out to serve God in the full-time ministry, I was blessed with her godly advice and counsel regarding legal matters pertaining to the church. She was always ready and willing to assist in any way she could. One of her outstanding characteristics was that she always did any work or responsibility with 100% effort and never half-heartedly or carelessly. She always gave her best for the Lord. We shall miss her, but we will remain with very fond and loving memories, especially of her beautiful spirit of service, from Pastor Ronnie and all the fellow ministers in Trinidad. Dear family of God abroad, may the God of all comfort be with you as one more warrior has left us for a hero's welcome on glory's shore. In the training center, Sister Barbara was a force to be reckoned with, in the best of ways if your end goal was entire sanctification. And even when we left the nest and were sent to other faith homes and eventually to take larger responsibilities, she was still used of the Lord to lay us mighty low, correcting us as a watchful mother over her brood. Over the years, Sister Barbara was both the concerned parent and also the respectful co-worker. From time to time, she would communicate with me in Papua New Guinea regarding aspects of the work here, but she would always let me know she was sincerely praying for me and would encourage me to be steadfast in the Lord. I am grateful to the Lord that I had a chance to communicate briefly with her during her time of illness and to thank her for the blessing she had been to me. Remembering a mother with you all, Brother Andrew, Port Moresby, Papua New Guinea. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints, Psalm 116, verse 15. We praise and thank the Lord for the life of our beloved Sister Barbara Bell, who is now in the eternal house of God, enjoying her beloved Jesus. Sister Barbara was a real example to me of diligence, discipline, faithfulness, steadfastness, etc. She was one of my trainers during my training time in Newark. Our beloved Sister Barbara never left anything undone that was given to her to do, no matter if she had to be up late night to finish it. She was a real hard-working servant and very responsible. Whatever she would do, whether big or small, she would do it to the best of her ability, and she wanted to impart that quality to us as well. Thank God for having completed his work in her life. May we all learn from her sacrificial and faithful life, and may we give our lives fully for the service of our Lord Jesus. From Sister Patricia and all the faithful workers in Ciudad Juarez, Mexico. To all the saints, we would like to praise and thank God for the work of grace completed in the life of our dearly beloved consecrated servant of the Lord, sister and fellow laborer, Barbara Bell. It was truly a pleasure to meet Sister Barbara and learn the many virtues of Christ, our Savior, reflected from her, such as humility and meekness. Her kind and gentle nature and compassion shown to us was truly able to draw many people, believers and workers to the Lord to fulfill God's word will in their lives. She displayed the mighty power of God through systematic explanation of the gospel. She lived to fulfill God's will and calling in her life. She served her master faithfully till the very end. The Lord has given our beloved sister rest from her labors together with the saints who have gone before. Well done, Sister Barbara. We shall see you when our Lord Jesus Christ will come with the other saints. From Pastor Andrew and all the co-workers in Malaysia. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the saints. We are sorry to hear of the home call of our dear Sister Barbara. Her valuable dedicated service to her Lord and Savior, to his church, and to his people will always be remembered. May God raise many more servants of God to work in his vineyard. From Brother Sean, Sister Sheila, Sister Karen, Sister Irene, and all the saints of the Edmonton Church. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. We thank God for the life of Sister Barbara, who endured all things till the very end by the love of God. Throughout her life, she was firm in her convictions and in her love for the family of God. It was quite evident in her words, spoken bluntly and yet in love, in her encouragement of the younger workers, and in her counsel faithfully given to steer each one in the direction of the Word of God. Her timely advice in various legal matters helped us to navigate different situations that could have been hurtful for the work of the ministry. Truly, her presence will be missed, but we know that today she is in the glorious presence of the Lord whom she served all her life. May the Lord, who has completed his work in her life, also help us to joyfully run our course, and may he bring comfort to the hearts of all the bereaved with the everlasting comfort that only he can give at this time. From Brother Blessed Sister Colleen and Sister Betsy in Houston, Faith Home.
Praise the Lord, and thank you, praise God, for Sister Barbara's life and her ministry. She loved the Lord Jesus Christ so much, and her love was shown towards the saints. And Sister Barbara was a real mother to me. I knew she loved us in Christ so much, and as it's already been mentioned, she used to correct me. And she used to correct me with all her heart. And I knew that she did it because she didn't want me to make the same mistake. The corrections were hard, but in the love of God. And those corrections really helped me to correct my life, and also to be faithful to God, and to be faithful to serve God. And I'm very, very grateful for the corrections. And I thank God for all the time that she would spend with me and the counsels that she would give me. And she also had a burden for my family also. And she would call and check on my mother, and she'd always ask about my brothers and sisters. And when my mother passed away, Sister Barbara took a burden and to prepare the funeral program and all the things that needed to be done. And she helped in any way that she could. And my family is from New Jersey, but they live a distance from here. So my mother was buried a good distance from Newark. So we decided to have the food at the old church that we used to go to. And Sister Barbara went early to the church to help to prepare the meal so that when everyone came back from the burial, the food would be ready for them. And it was a real labor of love, and all the family was so grateful and so thankful. Then my father passed away a few months after my mother in the same year, and I was in a different location, but Sister Barbara and another servant of God went to the funeral for me in my place. And that really touched my heart, my aunt's heart so much, and she kept talking about that. And Sister Barbara would always ask how I was doing, and she would always pray for me. She would share real live testimonies of battles and struggles in her own life,
and how God had caused her to overcome. I'll give one example. I came to her one day because I was having some back problems. And as I came to her, I said, Sister Barbara, please pray for me. I've been having these back problems. And then she shared with me how she had had back problems and how she had gone to Pastor Don to pray for her. And how he had shared with her how she has to fight these things and just resist them and pray. And then, and when she had gotten healed, so she prayed with me, and I also began to fight and resist, and the pain left. So I was really encouraged, and really encouraged my faith. And she was a woman of prayer and a woman of faith. She would always encourage me, no matter what was going on, she'd say, pray and trust God. He will take care of you. So she was very faithful to the very end. And the verse I have is in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Now abideth faith, hope, charity. But the greatest of these is charity. Thank God for the love of God that we've seen in her life. Praise the Lord.
So there's a friend. And it's deep. It's part of our life, I guess. The whole thing is, Sister Barbara to me was just a beautiful and elegant, dignified lady. I never knew her to be really angry or talk something terrible. You know, in 1 Timothy chapter 5, it says, some men's sins are open beforehand, going before to judgment. Some men they follow after. Likewise also the good works of some are manifest beforehand in they that are otherwise cannot be. And so the good works of Sister Barbara have just been seen over and over and over. I've seen her say, she was really hard on two sisters that I know of, and they were her daughters, and that was how that went. We share daughters, that's what we did. And she would come and she would say, you know, I have to get this and this. What do you think? You think this will be fine? You think this is okay? You know those two, they did the same thing. They would buy her stuff. They would get her something. It was not something that's unworthy somewhere, and they'd get her something. The two of them, they'd carry on. This was the sweetness that I saw passing between the younger ones and the older ones. It was so sweet. I have kind of a shameful testimony. I think it was the second year we were in Lynchburg Convention. And she was busy in that apartment. And she had this little wonderful thing she loved to do, is to make the bedrooms of the brothers just great. And they would have, my goodness, they'd have nice curtains and wonderful, beautiful beds made out of walls just so. And everything looked so neat and nice. And she came to me and she said, Sister Carolyn, you always know what's going on. Sister Carolyn, I went back. I was working in the bedroom and that one was there. In fact, the brother in room for them. It's not fixed up. Don't you think you better do something about it? Well, I never thought of it. I made her some, this offhand thing. Oh, Sister Barbara, worry about it. You know, he's over 21. He can have his room when he likes it. Something, on the gear. And she didn't think that was nice. And she came to me later and she said, don't worry, I took care of it. I went out and got everything for him just for myself. I did. And I thought to myself, you know what? I had gotten home about it. It wasn't a big deal to me that night, but it was a really big deal to her. Why should one brother have a room that doesn't look as nice as the others? That's not nice. And so she was like that. And some great example of those kind of things. Praise be to God.
I thank the Lord so much for the privilege that he gave me working with Sister Barbara. When I was thinking about, what to share, or if I would share, not because I don't want to, but just because how do you fit so much into just a few minutes, and the great blessing that she was for me and everything that I learned from her, it's kind of hard to squeeze it into just a few minutes, and also I just didn't trust myself to make it through, but anyway. When I was thinking about it, Sister Barbara and I had a conversation after coming back from a funeral, and for some reason or other, we were, you know, saying, well, if you die, if I die, or, you know, like that. And then she said, well, when I die, you know, but we were talking about saying something at the person's funeral. Are you going to say something? Are you going to testify like that? And she said, well, when I die, you're going to say something at my funeral. And I just kind of to tease her, because Barbara would laugh. She liked to laugh, and she liked to laugh at herself. But I just said, well, you know, no, I don't think I'll say anything. In fact, I might not go because I'll be too sad or something like that. But kind of just to bug her, I said, no, I'm not going to say anything. And then she looked at me, she's like, you better. You know, like when Sister Barbara said, you better, you better. So I kept thinking, you know, how am I going to get up there? I have so much in my heart, and it's hard to squeeze everything in. And I kept hearing Sister Barbara say, you better. And so I'm here, but not because I don't have anything to say. I thank the Lord so much for her. There's so many things I learned. She would do everything with all of her heart, like we heard in one of the letters, you know, she gave 100%. And whether she was cooking or cleaning or preaching, no matter what it was, she gave everything. And, you know, a lot of us, you know, we were blessed by her cooking, and I got to be in the kitchen with her when she would cook, and her ribs were wonderful. I think those who have tasted them knew that. But I saw her do it, and she poured her whole heart into it, even when she was sick. The past few months, just a few months ago, we made a meal in the church, and she wanted to be in the kitchen doing it. And I kept saying to her, please, you can't. And she would get up and do it, and sit down and get up again, but that was her heart. And she gave everything. Even someone mentioned about the rooms that she would make up. And for her, hospitality was not just to do it, but it was a ministry. Whoever came to the faith home, she wanted them to be ministered to. And her way of ministering to them, the love of the Lord, was to make them feel welcome. And I'll never forget. We were doing the room, and for me at first, you know, I thought, you make a bed, and that's it. But, you know, Sister Barbara, everything had to be just right. And some of the sisters remember the ruffles on the curtain. You know, when you put them in the curtain rod, the ruffles had to be standing straight up and full and out and just right. And you needed two people to do it. So one person was standing up on a ladder fixing, and the other person was standing down going, no, move it this way, because Sister Barbara was going to come and check. But one day, there was nobody to help me, and I just said, you know, whatever, I'm going to rush, and I'm going to finish it, and it'll be done. And I got on the ladder, and I did it myself, and I got down, and, you know, that was it. And of course, Sister Barbara came to inspect it. And she came, and she looked at the curtains, and she went, Clayton, did somebody help you? Did you get help? No, I did it myself. Yeah, I can tell. And, you know, so I had to get back up and fix that part. But at the moment, I was like, oh, we please just finish. But her attention to detail, that's what spoke to me. And I remember thinking about it later, and I was like, the attention to the details is what makes the difference. It's the difference between just a nice job and a job that makes you say, wow. And, you know, expressing the love of the Lord, because you love, you know, the saints of God so much that you'll take the time to let them know that the details really matter to you. And they did matter very much to her. I know there's so much, but I guess I just want to close with saying that one of the most important things that I learned from her was just in these past months, where she was in a lot of pain and suffering, but her faith in the Lord, she really held on to the Lord. And I remember one time she was in quite a bit of pain, and she was just sitting on the bed, and we were praying, and she was in so much pain, and she just kept saying, Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. And it spoke so much to me that in the midst of her suffering, she was just saying, Lord Jesus, I love you, clinging on to her trust in the Lord through the whole time. And in Philippians 3, verse 10 and 11, one of the passages that we read in the beginning, it says that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. And one time she was sitting on the bed and in pain, and she looked at me and she just said, well, Clayton, you know, that verse, the fellowship of his sufferings, that's one of my favorite verses. And she was saying it like, that's one of my favorite verses. And now, you know, the Lord had taken her down a path of pain and suffering. And openly, she would share sometimes in the messages. Just recently in Brooklyn, she would say, I don't like pain. I don't like to suffer. I don't like pain. You know, pain, it hurts, and suffering, it's no fun. But she would say it a lot. But she would say it like, you know, when it's our time to go through the trial, may the Lord help us and help her. And the Lord really gave her grace in her time of trial, in her time of suffering. And it's one thing for people to preach and say there's grace to go through your trial, there's grace to suffer, but it's another thing to see it lived out in front of you. And I thank the Lord so much because I was able to see that in her, and I know that there will be grace when it's my turn, or all of us, when we have to go through suffering or trials, that there will be grace. And the Lord gave her abundance of grace, and her prayer and desire was to
to be called, chosen, and faithful to the very end. And the Lord really gave her abundance of grace to be faithful to the end. And I know the Lord, you know, there were different things that she would say, different things that the Lord spoke, even to me, that, you know, in retrospect, I know the Lord was preparing her to take her. And I know many of you were praying that the Lord would heal her and raise her up. And she shared so many testimonies about how God had healed her. But it was the time of the Lord to take her. And I know everyone praying that that was what really kept her, strengthened her to stay faithful to the very end, because that's what she desired. And the song that we sang said, every longing will be satisfied. When suffering ceases and sorrows die, and every longing satisfied, then joy unspeakable will flood my soul. I am truly home. And I know her longing has been satisfied. She was longing to be faithful to the end, to make it. And we say, you know, oh, they're in a better place, but it's not just a better place, it's the best place. And I know she's made it home, and I thank the Lord so much for the privilege I had of knowing her and working with her. God bless you.
When I first met Sister Barbara in 99, when I came to the Christian school, I was actually kind of scared of her. But during that time, there was a teaching going on in the church about renouncing, confession, things I had never heard about in my life. And I felt the urge, I had to do these things. And when I wanted to, Sister Lisa was traveling and no one was here. She wasn't here. So I saw Sister Barbara sitting there and I said, well, I guess I'll go to her. And I asked her if I could come and see her, and she said yes. And you know, the Word of God says if we walk in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And I found that to be so true. The things I had to say were not pleasant, and for her to hear it was not pleasant. But from that day forward, a true bond came into our hearts, and she became my mother. And she would always check up on me. The following year, I joined the ministry, and we were under, as that email said, she was a force to be reckoned with in the training center. There were three of us sisters who were 20, so she called us her three musketeers. We were with her for waxing floors, stripping the floors, shampooing the carpets, painting, whatever task Sister Barbara was up to. We were her three little musketeers that followed behind. And I had never learned to work so hard in my life. But I'm telling you, she was so much more older, but I was ashamed I couldn't keep up with her. But not only was she there to teach us and supervise, but she was there to work with us. Many years I worked with her in getting the apartments ready for the pastors coming from overseas. And as they said, attention to detail. If there was a spot of paint in the corner of the bathroom, this isn't a university, we would get paint remover and scrub that thing off so the pastors wouldn't see it. Not only were we on our hands and knees, but so were Sister Barbara, taking stains off the carpets, fixing the curtains, as Clayton said. And although we only had to technically prepare two apartments, I remember one year we did about eight, because she would see other brothers and pastors' apartments that were not ready, and she would say, okay, let's do this. One day, Sister C.G. and I got so tired, I think we disappeared, and we fell on the floor and fell asleep. And Sister Barbara walked in. We were so ashamed because she was still working. Anyway, we got up and we continued working. After I came to the faithful, I hardly went to the store. Sister Barbara knew me. She knew what I liked. She would buy my clothes. She would buy my shoes. When she was in Trinidad, she would make outfits for me. She would get them done. Even this morning, as I was leaving Washington, I went to grab something out of my closet, and I realized Sister Barbara gave it to me in December. She just knew us, and she loved us. I remember she called me one day. She wanted to bring something to everybody in the faith home where I was at. She was asking me what to get, and then she said to me, Pearl, do you want any more of this? Something that she knew I liked. And I said, well, Sister Barbara, I don't want to ask. And she said, don't you know I'm your mother? You can ask me anything. And that's who she was. She called me Pearlie Mae, and I will miss hearing that from her. Sister Barbara, along all these things, I have never been scolded so much in my life as I was from Sister Barbara. Her correction sent me to the bathroom crying because I didn't want people to see it. And when she finished, she would either send me to Sister Lisa or Sister Joyce, depending on what it was, what she was scolding me for. And if I would say to her, I'm sorry, Sister Barbara, and she felt it wasn't truly genuine, she would say, no, you're not. You better search your heart more and know why you did that. And I really thank God because, you know, in working with her, the attention to detail that she had for all the physical things, she did for spiritual things, for her own life and for us, because she loved us. I remember when she was in Trinidad and I was in Guadeloupe, I had gone for youth camp. And afterwards I spent a few extra days there and she took me out, took me shopping, you know, bought me everything. And I was talking and talking and she discerned things in my talk and she called me to her room when we came home. And she said, you know, this and this and this, I think it's going to be very dangerous for your life. And when she said it, I knew God was speaking to me. And I thank God because maybe if she hadn't warned me, I could have really messed up on certain things. But because of her discernment and her warnings, God spared me. And I really want to thank God. I mean, there's so much I could say, but I just really thank God for her. In the last year, when she became weaker, I didn't know it at the beginning. But in December, she came to find out that I had a particular affliction and was having pain. And she kept in touch with me. She would email me, she would call me, and she would say, are you okay? Are you sleeping? Do you have pain? But I didn't know she was sick as well. And in January, at the Yes Retreat, she had to share. And she came and asked one of the servants of God to pray for her because she was having pain. And that's when I realized something was wrong. And Claylin had to go somewhere, so she wanted to take Sister Barbara, and I said, oh, I'll go with her. And I just held out my hand, just to be courteous, because it had snowed. And she held on to my hand all the way to the meeting hall. And this was Sister Barbara, who was so strong. And that's when I realized something was wrong. And in the last few months, we kept in touch. She checked up on me, I checked up on her. And in one of the emails she sent to me, she wrote about another worker who she felt was a mother. And she said, I hope one day somebody could say that about me. And I think we can all, and I especially can say she was a mother. And I'm having lost my physical mother a month ago, and I'm losing one of my spiritual mothers, I will truly miss her.
Really, I want to thank God for the grace and faithfulness of God. You know, that's just about my traditional race. But I miss her a lot. Not only a sister, but she's my big sister. I came to school Sister Barbara in a Pocono convention in 1983, and we worked together in the conventions. But when I first came to New Jersey from Canada, I stayed with her, and we get to know each other a lot more. And she came to ministry a year after me, but she had always like many people testify. We were in New Jersey for almost 12 years together. And we were most of the time sharing rooms together. We were almost the same age. And you know, she had picked my big sister, like supposed to say, she'd buy my clothes. I don't have to worry, go shopping. I hate shopping, but she loves me. And we worked together a lot. And after a while I said, you're not only my big sister, I'm your shadow. I said, because why? 1995, she went to Papua New Guinea. 1996, I went to Papua New Guinea. And then 2002, she went to India. 2003, I went to India. I said, I'm following you all the time. And she went to Rhode Island. I went to Rhode Island after her. So I know that I miss her a lot because she's not my mother, as you say, but she's my big sister. She's always on the lookout for me. Meeting time comes, she'll find space beside her for me. She know I'll be running around. And you know, she was, as you say, we were like purple fixtures in New Jersey. And we always make fun of each other. Look, we always under retraining. We are year after year, we are here. But we are happy, you know. We are happy in New Jersey. I don't want to leave New Jersey. But she went. And we shared a lot together. And I know sometimes, as you said, she's very, very detailed. And I'm tired. I said, oh, please, I'm happy to do all these things. She said, yes. If she was, and all I do is, I'll be fast asleep. I said, why would I waste time doing all these things? But I learned from her that every detail is very important. But you know, the last few months, I know she was sick. And I just don't want to believe that God is going to take her. That's all. I said, God, you cannot take her. You cannot take her. She does a lot. I said, she's very hardworking. Physically, she's strong. Spiritually, she's strong. And I know that once she makes something, she will not change her mind, you know. And, but I can say that we keep sharing each other how much God has forgiven us. And she said, you know, Joe, I live a wicked life. How much Jesus has forgiven me? And I have worked hard and labor hard with all that I have. And I know, I tell you, she worked very hard for the Lord. She worked very hard. And, you know, the last few months, she kept telling me, Joe, Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is coming soon. We have to be ready. The last few times I spoke to her, and now I can say that the Lord must have revealed to her he's coming soon for her. You know, and I thank God that many times I call, and sometimes I say, don't talk to her, don't pray. No, I don't have to talk to her. I know she's very tired. But the last Sunday I talked to her, and she spoke to me very softly. She said, I love you, and Jesus is coming soon, she told me. And I still don't want to believe that God was going to take her, you know. But I learned a lot from her, and I would say not only she's my big sister, but many times I escaped scolding because of what she did. The mistake she made, she'd come and tell me. Okay, I'll learn from your mistake. And I say, but God is holding from the elders too, from anybody. And I really missed her. Many things I can say because we were together for a long time in New Jersey. And she was over, you know, the hospital, like housekeeping, and I was the only kitchen. And we worked together a lot. And we were in the room together a lot. And Sister Barbara is the opposite of me. She's a hardcore person. I'm a very hard person. And just to say that we had fun together, when she needs a room to turn the heater, I will turn the heater on. When she comes in, she'll turn it on. And we don't argue, we don't anything. We just take it for granted, you know. And many things, we were really opposite. But we have a lot of disagreements, but we really love each other. And many people say, you two are real sisters, you know. And she's my big sister. I said that she's real in life, you know, but she really loves the Lord. And I know, she said, we have to work hard, labor hard for all that Jesus has done for us. She said, I'm always grateful. She said, you know, I'm a very wicked person. How can Jesus love me like that? She always said that. And I know she has a grateful, thankful heart. That's why she labored hard. And I tell you, she corrects me too. I'm always in a hurry. She said, say thank you, say please. And to all the other trainees too. She taught us a lot, I have to say that. You know? And I really appreciate it. And I know God has finished the work also. I want to be a channel. I want to be ready for the coming of the Lord. Amen.
Praise and thank God for the privilege God gave me to know such a beautiful person, my Sister Barbara. When I first came to New Jersey and I was in training, I thought Sister Barbara hated me because everything I did, she would always scold me, and I'm like, I don't know what I really did. Like, why is she always so mad at me? And then I was like, maybe she just doesn't like me. And so I would stay away from her. And I mean, if she came out of the room, I'd either run to my room or run to the closest bathroom. I mean, I would make sure she doesn't find me. And, you know, so I mean, I was so scared of her. And then one day what happened was this incident really, you know, gave me a great respect for her. She had a dream, and in this dream, one of the elders asked me to do something, and I said no. And the next day she called me, she said, Sitchi, she called me to her room, she said, I had this dream, the elder asked me to do this, and you said no. And I said, but Sister Barbara, it didn't happen, such a thing never happened. She said, no, I had this dream, and so she gave me a big scolding. Then she took me to Sister Lisa's room, she said, this is the dream I had, and this is the way she is, and she scolded me, said, this is really weird. I did not do such a thing. And then I was mad at God. I said, God, why did you give her this dream? Because if you didn't give her the dream, then I wouldn't get into all this trouble. Well, the thing was, right after that, about a week or so later, one of the elders asked me to do something, and I said, in my heart, a no was rising up. And as it was rising up, all of a sudden, I felt like, this happened before, but I didn't know where or when. I said, no, but this can't have happened. And then as I'm standing there, all of a sudden, I remember Sister Barbara's dream, the scolding. I was like, yes, yes, I'll do it. The elder was like, oh, you're willing to do it. I said, yes, yes, I'll do it. And I mean, after that, I just had such a great respect for her because I knew God had kept her for my protection, and God would. And there were other times too when I would go to her about something. I would tell her, you know, what happened, but she would see beyond. And she says, "You think this in your heart, and this is what's in your heart." And I'm like, "How does she see this?" I mean, it was. I don't know, but it was. I just had a great respect for her. And for example, one time we had worked late into the night, and during praising I fell asleep, and it was a time when a lot of different people had come, workers and believers, for recording or something. And during praising, she told one of the sisters to tap me and made me stand up for the whole hour of praising. And then different ones asked me, what's wrong with her? Why is she standing up, you know? And I was so embarrassed, so I thought, okay, praising's over, and that's done. I go for prayers, and of course I was dozing off again. She made me stand up again. I sat down a little while later, she told me, stand up again. 3 times in one day, I was like, oh my God, sister, I was just so embarrassed, you know? And then after prayers, you know, I was helping her with something, and I wasn't really talking to her. She said, is everything all right? I said, yes. There's something. She said, what? And then I told her, I said, Sister Barbara, you made me stand up 3 times in front of all the people. And she says, why are you mad at me? I was just trying to help you get rid of the devil. He put you to sleep. She would just say something little, and it would just silence all my questions. I mean, she just had a way of doing it, and she was such a dear mother, a dear sister, a dear friend, even though the age difference was quite a bit between us. And she was a teacher, a mentor, a counselor. She was so wise in her counsels, and she was extremely loving and caring and very funny. She would always make me laugh, and I'd get in trouble, you know, for laughing loud and, you know, things like that. And about a month ago, I had a dream that she passed away, and think God was just preparing me. And I had an opportunity to go see her, and I was telling her, I was like, Sister Barbara, I don't know when I'll get to see you again. She was like, have faith. And after she passed away, one verse that came to me was, do thy diligence to come unto me shortly, you know. And I was thinking, yes, have faith, Sister, you're going to see her shortly. And two things that comforted me is that she's not in pain anymore, and that she made it. And I will truly miss her, especially during conventions. I usually go with her, and I share a room with her sometimes. And especially this year, a few years ago, I was sick, and since then, she was always watching out for me. She would always be in the next room to me or in my room, and she would always watch out for me. And this year, I got to share a room with her and help her a little bit. And I really thank God for the privilege she gave me. She was truly a virtuous woman, and I will truly, truly miss her. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. I'm glad to have the opportunity to come before you and share who Sister Barbara was to me. I met her when she was transferred to Brooklyn about 4 or 5 years ago, and the first time I met her, she opened her arms to me, and at the time, she was a complete stranger to me, and you know, even though I didn't give her a warm welcome, she showered me with love and affection. I was always cautious and wary of strangers, and that's what she was to me, so I tried to keep her at arm's length for a long time. But she grabbed me by that arm, and she just unceasingly showed love, truly overwhelming love to me, to someone who wasn't, you know, reciprocating that feeling. I wasn't showing it to her. You know, I wouldn't be, you know, outwardly rude, but, you know, I would avoid her. You know, I couldn't understand why she was, you know, being so nice, trying so hard, you know, to get to me. She would constantly tell me that she loved me. She could call me baby. And, you know, just hearing that from someone who wasn't, you know, related to me by blood, you know, it was just, you know, it was new, it was different. But gradually, I began to, you know, to trust her and to care for her as well. She was always there for me. I knew whenever I needed to talk to her, her door and her heart was always open to me. I could tell her anything. I remember one time in particular, I confessed something to her. And it was Christmas Eve night, going to Christmas morning, and after I finished, I thought, well, I just ruined her Christmas with all of this. But she calmly, she sat there, she listened to me, and then she told me that she loved me. And to hear someone tell me that they love you after you unload all this garbage on them, you know, I just thought, that must be how Jesus loves us. And I thought, I was certain that I couldn't face her after telling her all these things. You know, I thought, no, I'm too embarrassed to even look her in the face. I thought I would stop up to church. I would be able to stay home and hide, but the opposite happened. You know, God, through that, he drew me close to her, and I actually started to come to the faith of more and more. You know, there were times when, you know, even coming to the Saturday night, it was a day. obviously loved that carefree as an individual and not just as one of the believers in the church, you know, that she has to, you know, she has to show that she cares for. She would always listen carefully to anything I said. She, when she spoke, her words brought comfort to me. She was also the first servant of God to talk to me about God's calling on my life to serve. She counseled me and encouraged me to step out in obedience to the Lord and to remain faithful to the Lord. I'm so grateful to the Lord for giving me such an amazing, supportive, and loving mom and sister Martha. She was much older than me, but I didn't consider her to be a grandmother. I didn't consider her to be old. When she would say she was old, I would tell her, no, you're not old. You can't say you're old until you're 90. And she looked at me and she said, I think Jesus fell out before then.
Fell asleep. And that's what Sister Barbara has accomplished.
She served, as we heard today, her own generation. She was truly a mother in Israel. All of the servants of God came and said she was a mother. That's extremely true. Praise God. Servants of God, sisters in our ministry, they are mothers. Truly, I can say tonight, there's a verse in Psalm 87 of Zion. It shall be said, this one and that one was born in her, and the highest himself shall establish her. And the Lord has done that work in Sister Barbara's life. Why don't you just praise God for this wonderful, fragrant, beautiful life, for a short time that the Lord gave us as a fragrant flower before us, and it was really a fragrant flower. And now in Zion, that fragrance is filling, praise God. She has left something behind for all of us to follow, her uprightness, her righteousness, her dedication, her truthfulness, her zeal, her so many things that we could learn from Sister Barbara's life. Why don't we lift up our hands and praise God for having finished that work.